Have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 9. And these are probably very familiar passages of Scripture to you. But this is just the way it came to me this afternoon. Matthew chapter 9. Verse 37, Jesus said to his disciples, "The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few." The harvest is truly plenteous, but the laborers are few. Then turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 22. Ezekiel chapter 22. And I want to look at verse 30. God speaking says, "I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none." Isn't that something? In a nation, he couldn't find a person. Turn with me to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6, and I want to draw your attention to verse 8. This is when Isaiah has an encounter with the Lord. "Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?' Then I said, 'Here am I, send me.'" Isn't that something when the Lord said, "Who can I send? Who can I send? Who can go for me? Who can I send out to represent me?" I've been talking to the Lord for quite some time, probably over a year or so, concerning the church as well as the Bible college. Some things concern me. I probably won't be here forever. Maybe not past 200, you know. And I think it's wise that you make plans for the future. Turn with me to Numbers chapter 27, and I'll show you where I'm coming from. Numbers chapter 27, I want to begin reading with verse 16. Numbers 27. Actually, I'll start with 15. "Moses spoke unto the Lord, saying, 'Let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh.'" Now that got my attention. I know I've read that many times. The God of the spirits. And if you look that word flesh up, it's saying body. The God of the spirits of the body. I'll let you think about that, all right? "Let the God of the spirits of all flesh set a man over the congregation, which may go out before them, and which may go in before them, and which may lead them out, and which may bring them in, that the congregation of the Lord be not as sheep who have no shepherd. And the Lord said to Moses, 'Take you Joshua the son of Nun, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay your hand upon him, and set him before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation, and give him a charge in their sight. And you shall put some of your honor upon him, that all the congregation of the children of Israel may be obedient. And he shall stand before Eleazar the priest, who shall ask counsel for him after the judgment of the Urim before the Lord. At his word shall they go out, and at his word they shall come in, both he and all the children of Israel with him, even all the congregation. And Moses did as the Lord commanded him, and he took Joshua and set him before Eleazar the priest and before all the congregation. And he laid his hands upon him and gave him a charge as the Lord commanded by the hand of Moses. God had spoken to Moses, who was 120 years old, about time for him to go ahead and check out. He had finished what he was going to do. He was not going to go into the promised land. And Moses is has come to the conclusion that, you know, he missed it, so he's not going to go into the promised land. But he said, God, don't leave the nation without a leader. He wanted to know that they would be taken care of. They would be true to the vision that God had given Moses. And so the Lord told him to take Joshua, and Joshua had been had served Moses well all these years, had been faithful in everything he had done. He was one of the spies that went into the promised land that came back with a good report. And God said, all right, there's your man. That's the one that'll do it. And you go ahead now and set him before the congregation so that they'll know that he's already handpicked and they're not going to have to vote on this. All right? I was reading in, just in my regular reading, it just happened to be there with David at, toward the end of his life when he's wanted to build a house for God, and the Lord's told him that his son will build it, that he's not going to be able to build the house. And so, you know, there where David numbered the people and did wrong, and judgment of God fell on the nation, and several thousand lost their lives. And then David talked to the Lord about it, and the Lord had stopped the angel from destroying there at the threshing floor of Ornah. And then David purchased that land. The Lord told him to offer sacrifice. David purchased the land, and the tabernacle of Moses was still in existence at the time, but it says that David couldn't go up to it because of fear of the angel of the Lord, that destroying angel. So he was afraid to go up there. So he bought the land, bought the threshing floor, bought the oxen, the wood, everything that he needed, and he offered a sacrifice to the Lord there at Ornah's threshing floor. And then when you go into the next chapter, David said, this is the house of God. And then it goes into him gathering materials, having the stones cut, gathering the brass, the gold, the silver, all these things. He said, Solomon's young and inexperienced, so I'm going to make preparation for him. And so David did all that preparation, and then he gave Solomon the command to build the house of the Lord. And he said, God told me, God called Solomon by name. He said, your son will succeed you. He'll build the house. His name will, the son that will do it, his name will be Solomon. Interesting how God had set a person, and David saw that person before he left, and David was able to give a charge to his son, Solomon. And I've been talking to the Lord about, you know, who's going to rise up? Who's going to rise up and lead the church in according to your vision and not come in with their own vision and take it off course? Or who will rise up in the Bible college and keep the Bible college on course? Because people find out that they can make money with this, and then they use it for the wrong motive. Instead of freely you've received, freely given, instead of putting the Word of God into people that really can't afford it, instead of working with people in an unorthodox way to get the Word of God in their life, someone might just come in and try to make a business out of it. And that I don't want. You understand? Just like Moses wanted the nation of Israel to stay on course and do what it was supposed to do, possess the land. I want this church to do what it's supposed to do. I want it to fulfill its vision in reaching out to the world. I see people going out of this church and ministering all over the world. We've done it to a degree, just a glimpse. As a matter of fact, excuse me, we have Richard going out next month, I guess it is, going to India. And he and his brother, and I think there's five of them that are going. Well, God has put us in a position to where we can pay for them to go to where they don't have to. Richard doesn't have to worry about raising money. Or we've been talking to Dale and different ones. You know, God moves on your heart and you feel like that you're supposed to do this, then let's sit down and talk about it, and let's get the Word of God throughout the nations of the world. We're to reach out to the world. And God's given us tools to do that. Through the website is one method. Through books, through audio books, through the college. We have so many ways to reach out. And I don't want to see this stopped. I want to see it accelerate. My role is lay a foundation. I'm just a foundation person. You understand? And so what we're here to do is lay a foundation so others can build upon, but beware how you build upon it. You understand? Isn't that what Paul said? As a wise master builder, I've laid the foundation. Beware how you build on it. So these are things that concern me, and I got to thinking about this. And I don't know if you guys probably don't even know what initiated me being in the ministry. But I'm just going to share some things with you. In the 70s, I'll just put it that way, I was in a church serving on a board that I don't agree with having. But anyway, I was there serving on the board, and there were some problems going on in the church, and the people were wrong, and the oversight was wrong, but the oversight was using the pulpit to beat up the people, to just, it was using it wrong. Instead of preaching the gospel, instead of using that to get the Word of God out, it was just using it more of a platform to where it could fight the people, and it was bothering me. And I really been praying about it, and I was really grieved in my spirit about it. And I was in the middle because I knew the people were wrong, so I didn't agree with the people. And I knew he was wrong, so I didn't agree with him. And so you got both sides ill with you because you know that both of them are wrong. And one Sunday afternoon, it was so heavy on me that it got me to tears. And I made a statement from Isaiah chapter 6. I said, Lord, I'm to the point, like Isaiah said when you said, Can I sin? I said, here am I, send me, because I wouldn't do that. I won't misrepresent you. I won't use the pulpit to my advantage. I didn't think any more about it. I mean, you know, I've got a job, I'm happy, everything's going fine. And in a few years, the Lord started dealing with me. And we were studying and drawing near to the Lord and had been exposed to some things that I'd never been exposed to in my life as far as the Spirit of God and the power of God moving. And it stirred up a hunger in me to know Him. I wanted to know Him. And so, sure, as a witness to all this, all I wanted to do was study. I'd read and study all the time. To the point that I was like a hermit. Just get alone. Close the door. Just stay in the room and study. Because there was a passion on the inside to know the Lord. And as this developed, the Lord started speaking through people that would come in to minister, and they'd just call me out and tell me things, just indicating things that I would be going into the ministry. I never felt like I'd run from God, run from the ministry, anything like that, but all of a sudden things are changing in my life. And so I would put those things on the shelf. I don't just jump and run when somebody prophesies, you understand. I take that thing before the Lord, and if I don't fully understand it, we just put it on the shelf and let it, just keep it in the incubator, and if it's God, it'll grow, you understand. And through a series of events, you know, we teach in Sunday school, and then I was asked to start teaching a home Bible study. And so I agreed to do that. That was on a Thursday night. So I would leave work on Thursdays and go straight to that place. I would take my clothes with me, change clothes to where I'd look halfway decent, you know. And so I would go in and teach that Bible study. And this went on for about 6 months, and then I was asked if I would teach another Bible study from another church on Tuesday night. And so I agreed to do that. And so then we're leaving work on Tuesdays and then on Thursdays, and we're teaching. And then all of a sudden, well, not all of a sudden, but it appeared that all of a sudden the things that had captivated my attention in the past were not moving me anymore. It's like you're losing interest here and you're gaining interest here. And, you know, there for a short period of time, I felt like, you know, the Lord really ought to speak to me about just making a move and going into ministry. And I remember going into work one morning, and I'd been talking to the Lord, and when I went in, I put my hand on the doorknob to go in the office. I just looked up. I said, Lord, if you want me to stay here the rest of my life and teach these Bible studies in Sunday school, I'm all right with that. I mean, I meant that. I'm all right with that. I got a peace. It just settled in me. And then shortly after that, driving to work, going down 68 there at Ocala Dam, the Spirit of the Lord said, it's time to leave. I had to get willing to stay before it was time to leave. I had to get things settled on the inside of me. And so we worked our notice and we left the secular work to go into the ministry, and we didn't have anywhere to preach. Well, they did call me and ask me if I, when I turned my notice, the day I turned my notice in, I got a phone call at work asking me if I could take vacation to go preach a revival. Just to show you how God works, you know. And so I did that in a, I won't say what it was, just an independent church of a denomination different than what I grew up in. And they wanted to be introduced to the Holy Spirit. And so I went up there for 10 days. We preached on, taught on the Holy Spirit and laid hands on people. And many people were baptized in the Holy Spirit. And some people were healed during the meeting. And then when that was over, I had nowhere to preach. So I would get up just like I did every day. And when I worked, I'd get up, go in there, take my shower and get dressed and go to work reading the Bible, studying the Bible. I'd do that all day long. And for a long time, wasn't it? A long time. God called me out, but no one wanted my services. And then, you know, through a series of events, things happened, and I was lying in the floor of the den at the house, you know, I'm working. I'm praying. I've been studying. I'm laying there, and I'm talking to the Lord, and obviously I'm there by myself. Sure, he's working, and kids are at school. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, "You'll interim pastor at such and such a church." Well, I didn't say anything to anybody. I didn't say anything to Sherry or anyone else. I just said to myself, if it's God, it'll happen. If it's not, I'll miss God. I just thought I heard. Well, through a series of events, that happened, and we ended up being at that place as an interim for 6 years. And then things changed. But in those 6 years, God was growing me, getting me to be more dependent upon Him, less dependent upon outlines that I would write and all this, to where He was teaching me how to be led by the Spirit of God by practicing. And I'm going to tell you this, it is extremely uncomfortable to the flesh. But it's very exhilarating when you see what God told you to do and you do it, when you see the result of it, then that's very exhilarating to you. Now you know you heard God. And then, you know, it wasn't the best situation in the world when we left the other church, and I didn't want to ever pastor again. I didn't want to in the first place. But the Lord said, I said, let me be as an assistant. But that didn't work. And then shortly after I left the other church, I was driving home, and about a half a mile before I got home, the Lord said, Thomasville World Outreach Center. And I said out loud, Lord, I don't ever want to pastor another church as long as I live. And then I said, but if I'll do whatever you want me to do. Well, I didn't hear any more about that. I didn't pursue it. That was in 92. In 1995, I was getting ready to go to India. And that Monday, the first of that week, I was leaving at the end of the week to go to India. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me. And I won't give you all the detail, but I knew when He spoke to me, He told me to give birth to the baby. I was pregnant to give birth. And I knew exactly what He was talking about. And it rattled my cage, I'll just tell you that. To the point that I had the name approved through the Secretary of State with a tax ID number before I left to go to India. That's how convinced I was that God spoke. And then I left and went to India, and through many hours of travel, or I should say days, I just decided I'd take the trip straight through. Don't ever do that. But then by the time I got there, I was like a zombie and just wanted to get to the hotel room and crash. But when I finally did get to the hotel room, I just laid across the bed. I laid my Bible and legal pad and pencil down, and I just laid across the bed, shoes and all, thinking that I would just sort of go into a deep coma for a while. And the presence of the Lord filled the room. I didn't see anything. I had no vision. But the Lord started talking to me about the vision of Thomas World Outreach Center. And actually, it started out with a mild rebuke. He told me, he said, "You've taken the name too frivolously." And I sat on the side of the bed. I got my legal pad, and he gave me Thomas World Outreach in an acrostic, TWOC. Thomasville being the location. World being what we were to focus on. Outreach, a place to reach out. The center being that, a center from where you reach out. And he told me that, he said, "I do not want a community church. I want it to be an outreach center to where your focus is the world." He said, "You will not reach all the world, but you are to reach out to any part of the world and all parts of the world." So there's no exclusions. And, we've done a lot of international traveling to a lot of different countries. As a result, it gave us some contact. And then through a series of events, we were led, Annette being led to develop the website for the Bible College. And here again, the Lord spoke to me about the Bible College in 1981. Same way, stood up, they're getting ready to dismiss the service. I wasn't even in the ministry. And as I stood up, just like I'm talking right now, I know it wasn't audible, it was inside, but it's just as real. I heard Spirit Training Center. And I knew that was God. And so we carried that 19 years before it was ever birthed. You understand? These things, what I'm saying is it was birthed by God, and you want this thing cared for. You want people that have a passion and a heart for God. I don't want people that have a passion for Pete or a passion for the church or a passion for the college. I want them to have a passion for God, for the Lord Jesus Christ. You understand? It's not... And don't misunderstand me, because I appreciate this. I've had many people to tell me that, you know, if they could help me, that they would help me. I want people not to help me. I want people to respond to the call of God, to where it's a passion of God. Whatever you're doing, you do it because God ordained that. Not just to fill in, to do this, to do that, but because God did that, it becomes a calling now. And as you respond to that calling and you're faithful to God, then it's a commission, it's a mandate that you must fulfill. And as I was thinking about all these things, I thought, well, the Lord said, who can I send? And I got to thinking about that. Who can I send? What's the qualifying characteristics that God's looking for? It's not your great education. It's not your great abilities and all these things. So what is it that God is looking for? Faithfulness. Who can I trust? Who can I trust to do exactly what I want done? That's one. And we call that faithfulness. Then the other thing is, who is committed to the point that that will be the priority in their life, to where nothing else matters but that commitment, that mandate. That's what will be the passion that motivates them to do what they do. Who's committed? And then the other thing was, they have to be discipled. But not discipled by man. Discipled by the Lord Himself. Now, He may use people, don't misunderstand me. But instead of hearing what so-and-so says, a lot of people say, well, Pete said, or so-and-so said. No, you have to know it's what God said. Did Pete say it or did God say it? Did you hear Pete or did you hear God? When you hear God saying it, it doesn't matter whose mouth it comes out of. When you hear God saying it, then you know that that is a mandate given to you by God. Now, what are you going to do with it? Jesus was concerned about His ministry being carried on. So what did He do? He selected, after much prayer, prayed all night before He chose the 12. And even at that, knowing one of them was going to betray Him. Interesting. But He was depending upon those men to carry on what He started. Not deviating from the pattern, but to carry on what He started. Now, they went through some processes. And it wasn't until they were filled with the Spirit of God that they became fit representatives for the Lord. Judas betrayed Him. Every one of them left Him alone in the Garden of Gethsemane to protect their own hide. Peter denied Him. But after they were filled with the Holy Spirit, those remaining ones represented Him well, to the point of even giving their lives, most of them, for the cause of Christ. When I look at Acts, the first chapter, it says, the former treatise of I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began to do and to teach. So what were they doing? Carrying on the ministry that Jesus started. That's what He was depending upon them to do. That's why He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Make disciples of all nations. The mandate. You understand? And I guess I'm feeling that as I get older, that I want people who are trustworthy, committed, that will do whatever it takes to become a disciple of Jesus, to know the heart of the Father, to operate with the mind of Christ, and to be led by the Spirit of God. That's what I want to say. Is that asking too much? See, I don't think it's asking too much, but the problem is, I don't see this in the world as a whole. I don't see it in the churches. Commitment is not something that people want to hear. I mean, sure, I can tell you some things about commitment. Commitment is when we're getting ready to walk out of the house to go do something and the telephone rings and then all of a sudden duty calls. Many times. Right? And so it ends up, I go one direction and she goes another direction. I may get tied up for hours. Because ministry is not 8 to 5. Sometimes ministry can be 15, 16 hours a day. Can't it? Now we're talking about commitment. And I'm going to tell you what motivates one to do that. Is the passion of the Lord and knowing your mandate. That's what motivates that. It's not trying to please somebody. It's not trying to receive accolades and where people say, well, he's a good pastor, he's a good this, he's a good that. That's irrelevant to me. Most of them probably said I wasn't. But that's irrelevant. I obeyed God. The chips fall where they may. But I know this, I have a heart void of offense between God and man. I want to see that. I want to see people, and I believe that this church is probably one of the most unique churches, or the most unique church I've ever been associated with, and the people have a different mind. And yet there's a remnant. There's always more on Sunday mornings than there are on Sunday nights. Have you ever noticed that? In any church. But even at that, who will give their life for the Lord? And I don't think people have come to the grips with this. That it's not just that Jesus gave his life for us. But the disciple gives his life for the master. When he said, if you're going to be a disciple, count the cost. You have to take up your cross daily. Deny yourself. Take up your cross. Paul called it being crucified with Jesus. Dead to the desires of the flesh, very alive to the passion of the heart of the Lord, where Christ can live his life in you, then forsaken all. That's not popular. Fathers, mothers, brothers, sisters, wife, possessions. So what does it cost? Everything. We turn it over to the Lord. Everything's given to the Lord. To where you believe in God and you trust God to the point that if I obey you and I do what you tell me to do, that this other is going to be worked out. Not being irresponsible on my part, but actually the very opposite, being extremely responsible because you're being led by the Spirit of God to do what you're called to do. I'm not talking about a religious job. I'm talking about being led by the Spirit and the passion for the Lord. And the flesh gets tired sometimes. But the passion on the inside of you overcomes that. You understand? To where you have to, I mean, you look at Jesus' life, I don't see how he operated praying all night, ministering all day. No wonder he could sleep in a storm. Now, there's other things that go with that as well, okay? But what was he doing? He was giving his life for the cause of humanity needing that Redeemer. Now, think of David when he goes against all odds to face Goliath, and his relatives, brothers, are the ones that reprimand him. And he says, is there not a cause? What concerns me today is people don't realize the cause. Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. That ministry is to continue. You understand? I came up here this afternoon and this was just turning on the inside of me. And I remember a song many years ago, Lanny Wolf wrote it and sung it. Anybody that knows him? My house is full, but my fields is empty. Who will go to work for me today? I'm just playing that, reminding myself. It's so easy for people to come together and just enjoy a service. It's easy to have the good music and the lifting the hands and all this and just be in an atmosphere that is enjoyable. But how about out there where the wolves are? That's where the ministry is. That's where the hurting people are. That's where Jesus did a lot of ministry. In the fields, on the mountain, on the hillside, wherever. Because status quo didn't want him. And the closer you get to the Lord, you're going to find that status quo is not real interested in you. But then we're not real interested in status quo. We're interested in hearing the Father say, well done, good and faithful servant. Amen. So, God's looking. There's an invitation out. It's not a draft. You understand? It's not a draft. Actually, what I'm doing, I'm not giving you the posters and telling you about all the adventure and all these things like the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Coast Guard and all day. No, that's not it at all. It's an invitation. Who will give their life for me? That's why it doesn't have many volunteers. Because people don't want to give up their self-life in pursuit of the Lord. Heavy? True. It's true. And so my position this evening is to put the invitation out. Jesus died for you. Will you die for him? And I'm talking about commitment to where if it's between you and him, you'll choose what he wants to do over what you want to do. That's what I'm talking about. And it can cause you to miss some events. Now, I just believe in putting everything above board and telling it like it is. No deceptions, no coercions. See, this is what I want to see in the church is what I want to see in the Bible college. People who will give their life for the Lord. Here am I. Who can I send? Who can I trust? Who is committed? Who wants to be my disciple? Who wants to act like me instead of acting like themselves? That's who I want to send. Now, the ball's in your court. You let that word go in you, and then you choose how close you want to be to the Lord. See, disciples can be multitudes that are seeing spectacular things and enjoying the food that's been supernaturally provided. Or there are some that can actually get involved in gifts of the Spirit and just using the name of Jesus, the authority of the name of Jesus, and cast out devils. And then there's 12 that said, we forsaken all. Those are the ones that were selected to represent Jesus after he left. And then out of that 12, there were 3 that went with Jesus in places no one else went. Peter, James, and John. And then out of the 3, there was the one called the Beloved that was so close to Jesus. He's the one who received the revelation of Jesus. John knew him as a person, but in that revelation, what he saw was not like anything he saw walking earth. Hair like wool, white like wool, eyes like a flame of fire. I mean, it was an awesome sight that he saw, voice like many waters. You understand? The true revelation. I believe that the revelation that you get of the Lord is contingent upon your commitment to the Lord. Can I trust them? Not to write a book and make a lot of money off of a revelation or a vision. But can I trust them with that revelation to live it out? To be more like me. Amen? Amen. Who can I send? Who will represent me? Not religion, not denomination, not a church. Who'll represent me? So that's what the Lord's saying. He's looking for someone who will represent him in truth and in spirit. Is it you? Only you can answer that. And the way you answer that is not with your mouth. It's with your actions. That's it. Any volunteers? Think about it. Amen.
Father, I thank you that you bless us indeed. You enlarge our territory. Your hand's with us to keep us from evil so that we do not cause pain. And I thank you for blessing us and keeping us and for making your face to shine upon us and being gracious unto us. You lift up your countenance upon us and you give us peace. So, Lord, we gladly invite you to rise up. Let your enemies be scattered and let those who hate you flee before you. Amen. Amen. Amen.